We need to understand costs so that we can trade off them against each other, and this can be done for the entire economy. This is what I'm going to show you. So where's South Africa? I like showing this picture because the very first time we did this calculation was in 1996. Logistics costs as a percentage of GDP. It's a rough calculation, but a lot of people used it for many years, 18%. And I stopped doing it, and there was a visionary here. There he sits, Hans. And he was at the CSR at that stage, and he said, we should do this for South Africa on an annual basis. Great, that was a wonderful piece of vision. So we're doing it for Africa on an annual basis. We won't do it this year, because there's no interest in doing it, but which is good. But we might be doing it this year. So at the moment, it's sitting at 11.8%, more or less. Logistics cost is a percentage of GDP. But this is not enough to know this. It's improved, but since deteriorated. We know what the cost elements is. We know in 2014, it was 244 billion rand for transport, and then all the other elements that you see there. So we know this. We're quite happy that we know this. We know what the actual quantum is. We're sitting at about half a trillion at the moment. This is the percentages. It's the same percentages, but I've changed the scale. Why? I've worked out logistics costs as a percentage of the transportable GDP. So I've taken services out of the calculation. This will tell us, on average, what is the value of logistics within each commodity that we consume, physical stuff. And that's more than half. So if you've got a 25% inefficiency on a national scale in your logistics system, then everything in your economy is 12% too expensive. The work that we're doing in India is fantastic as far as this is concerned, because they are very disorganized people, but growing with fast and furious focus, which is wonderful. Okay, but this relationship is still functional. Hans, this is, we still cannot trade them off against each other on a national level, and that's what we started doing at the moment. So how can we improve? We talk a lot, and I saw in a previous presentation, we have this long distances and so on. Makes things expensive. There's not everything that we can do about it, because those long distances are given. You're landlocked, you're far from the port, etc. But what can you do? This is what I'm going to talk about. One thing to look at it is to look at GDP, dollars you get for every ton kilometer that you put into your economy. Okay? If you understand what I mean, the world's got a GDP of about $75 trillion. It's got ton kilometers about surface, 32 trillion. So you get in the world about $2.3 for every ton kilometer that you consume. That's the input, GDP is the output. For South Africa, it's 1.2. That's the reason. We have long distances. Our demand for transport is very high. But remember, if our demand for transport is high, if your demand within a business for something is higher than your competition, it's a strategic commodity that you manage well. You should manage it well. What causes high logistics costs? Well, demand could be high for lots of reasons. Spatial, we just have big distances, but it can also be a lack of beneficiation. So remember, if you industrialize, you add value to commodities, and the relative logistics cost of high value commodities is low. So one way of improving it is to industrialize, for all the other reasons that we talk about, but also now. And access of choice. When I grew up, we had 4 bars of soap to choose from, Palmolive, Lux, 2 others. These days there's 100 types of soap on supermarket shelves. It means each one of those soap types, buffer stock, cycle stock, everything has to be kept in place. Choice makes us consumers that need more. And then there's expensive or inefficient supply. Top on the list for me is all those modal choice, how much do we move to rail? But then there's all the other things that you can do to make, for instance, your road transport more efficient. I'm looking at Paul there. He's a guru in South Africa about all of these things. He works on it. And there's the things that you can improve, so you can do it. But can you work out what each improvement, each logistics policy and infrastructure intervention in the economy from the same base of ABC costing, the way that the business is doing it, can you work out what the benefits for yourself is? So, we started doing that. We said, okay, let's build a freight flow model for South Africa. Let's understand all flows in the country now and 30 years into the future. And we've built this. And this is the beginning of our instrumentation. We've done it for 83 commodities. I'm just showing 4. Those are between 400 districts in the country. Those are for tons, ton kilometers, for all modes and costs. Big model. works well for us. And when we added cost and we started playing with it, we found something really, really interesting. We took those costs and we said, let's segment all of these flows, because there's many of them, into various segmentations, because every segmentation will behave differently. Secondly, let's work out all the cost elements. The 80 billion that we pay for fuel in order to keep our logistics system going, the about 30 billion that we pay for driver's wages, etc. Take all of those elements. Let's take the cost drivers. If the truck is empty, the cost is higher. If the truck's to install, the cost is higher. If it's stuck at the border, the cost is higher. If you drive the truck further, the cost is lower. If the fuel consumption, if the vehicle has got an efficient drivetrain, the cost is lower. Take all of those things and we mix them all together and we find the systemic trade-offs. If you do this in the economy, this will happen. And I'll show you examples. Let me just start with this one. I've shown this picture often, I like it, because it looks like a train. And it's not a train. It's the N3 when it snows once in 20 years. Then all the trucks get stuck there. And you see, well, that should have been the train. Now you can see it. You know, you couldn't see it before, but it should have been a train. It's simple. It's a tragedy. So why does this work? Well, we have all these manufacturers in South Africa. They send their stuff to distribution centers. Over a long distance, it goes to another one. And it goes to a retailer. We know that, okay? And we also know that's stupid, and this is what we should have done. Should have had a massive terminal outside Cape Town, outside Johannesburg, outside Durban, and we should catch these things in this terminal, intermodal solutions. We have enough volumes to do it. But we were stupid enough not to do it up to now. What can we do with our model? We press a few buttons. It says if you go from that to that, you get that. We can actually tell you there's 50 million tons that could move that's suited for this type of solution. Over 30 billion ton kilometers, it will save the economy 7 billion. Right. We know that. And even in our model, we can say it will save you 400,000 tons of emissions just by pressing the buttons in our model. So you can take this further. I like showing this because it's fun for me. Currently, if you have 2,000 trucks per day, trips on ATCOR, if we aggressively move everything to rail that we should, those road trips in 30 years will be 4,500. It'll also grow. Don't stop. Rail will also grow. If rail keeps its current market share, it will be 6,500. If we stagnate rail, it will be 8,000. Okay, so we don't want instead of two lanes, want eight lanes, both directions on the network. So we can see it now. We can get it out of the model. Why do we struggle with this? The one reason is the tragedy of the commons effect. What does it say? If you haven't read this article by Hardin, you should read it. It says, if you have a lot of herdsmen in a common pasture, every time one of them adds one sheep, he makes a lot of money. But every time one sheep is added, the pasture goes down a little bit. You can't see it. Until there's lots of herdsmen that's done it, and then the whole pasture dies, and you're dead in the water. The failure of infrastructure. I hear everything about all of these projects that the previous speaker also talked about. But can we, on a national scale, do what companies do? So this is all my projects. This is the trade-offs that I've done amongst them. I've done it from the same cost base, and this is the answer that I get for that. Can we do it for policy? We run around and say, provincial roads, we're going to reduce the axle load, we're going to introduce a congestion charge, we're going to stop trucks from driving in. But do we exactly know what the effect of those policy changes will be? Well, if you have a model that sits behind every flow, and you understand the drivers of every flow, yes, you can work it out. And you can use that to confirm what you want to do, and I'll show you some examples. And then we as logisticians failed, because this theory is missing from the textbooks. It's not in there. But hold your hats, we are writing it. So get in there. So how can you do it? Well, we played a little game, and we're not going to give you the answer of the game because we spent a lot of time doing it and somebody must come and engage with us. But we took 22 possible industrialization projects for South Africa. Ferromanganese smelter at Kuga, new vehicle plant in P, a crude and gas refinery at Kuga. Go on, fracking is in there, some nuclear power stations, I should take them off, and some other stuff, you know, the Dubi trade port, take it further, all of that cement plant at Kuga. And for that, we can tell you, if you do that, the freight flow landscape in South Africa will change. So, induced industries, because things will happen, well, this will happen. This will be the effect of transport costs and relative to logistics costs in South Africa, of externality costs, and where logistics apps should be formed. and how you reconfigure your port system. Well, we've done a lot of work in South Africa, and a lot of people have supported us, which is great. At the moment, not so much. That was great. So the next thing we did, we built a freight flow model for the whole of Sub-Saharan Africa. We've got one for the whole of Sub-Saharan Africa, which nobody uses. So we thought, okay, let's go on. So we moved to India. We've got a fantastic opportunity in India. We're doing a lot of work in India at the moment. I've been there 8 times over the last 12 months. So, and our freight demand model for India is in place. We've been contracted by Vietnam, so we're doing one for Vietnam at the moment. China has invited us, been there once, to talk to the Department of Transport. We'll probably take it further. And Turkey is on the horizon. I'm mentioning that because from that, I can give you examples what it is that I'm talking about. Let me start with trade. This is, in 2014, South Africa's 429 billion rand logistics cost. Okay? Of that, 101 billion is domestic for trade. So it comes back to what the previous speaker has said. That 101 billion that you see there is what we spend inside the country in order to trade. It's freight that eventually crosses the key wall or comes over the key wall into South Africa. Then you have to pay the port 23 billion. It's roughly what we pay Transnet, port terminals and the NPA, and once some other, and you have to pay the shipping line 95 billion. To get it overseas. So yeah, that's a very basic rough supply chain. But what is this? Look at that 101 and look at it now. We've calculated, because we have the model, if this wasn't a trade supply chain, but everything else was the same, it actually only would have cost 84. The 18 billion is the induced effect of the port. It's because the truck is stuck in the port. It's because the inventory carrying cost is longer. It's because the management and admin cost is more. It's because the unit cost of transport is higher. Because if a truck stands in the port, it cannot earn money, and all the transport on that truck becomes less or more expensive over the year. And the same in the ship side, 5 billion. It's lost because ships is at anchor before ports. In fact, we can tell you for every day on average that the ship gets stuck in a port, how much more it will become. Induced cost of 23 billion, or so that's 18 plus the 5. You know what it means? It means we lose as much in logistics costs outside of ports as we pay the ports. So if you can make the ports 50% more efficient, you can pay them 20% more and you'll have a deal. Do you know this? You don't know this because you don't have something like this. And then we've also seen that 18, we think it's now sitting at 23. It's an old calculation. Because of what we hear these days. And by the way, I just want to say, these people from Transnet here, delays at ports are not only caused by Transnet. Let me just make a statement. It's coordination with industry and a lot of things that industry do as well. So let me use a policy example. This is a nice one. We got a lot of accolades for this sum, just a simple sum that we've done. This is transport costs in South Africa, and that's externality costs. Externality costs we calculate, also in our model, for every flow. Accidents, emissions, noise, congestion, excessive land use and policing. So we pay about 12 billion each for accidents and emissions and then all the others. And then we play the game. We say, well, road and rail is different. We know that. So our road emission externality costs about 4.5 cents per ton kilometer. That's what society for emissions. That society pays, the road all year doesn't pay it. And then for rail it's less. But it's also less productivity because we have the model. So now we play the game. We said, okay, what is that figure at the moment? You pay the railway so much, you pay the road operator so much, and when I say pay the road operators, it includes in-house transport, all transport. And this is the externality cost, it's gone. Society have to pay for it. What if, this is just a big what if we force every flow to carry each externality cost? So we eradicate the externality cost by putting it internal. What will happen with the sum? Strangely enough, it will be less than the current internal cost. Why would that be? It's a very simple reason. Rail is a fixed cost business. The unit cost of rail comes down a huge amount if you've put more on the rail. So if you understand, if you make a systemic change in your economy by putting everything on the rail that should be there because it's cheaper for the right reasons, then rail, the actual cost of rail that you currently have, becomes down tremendously. And your total cost comes less. You can eradicate externalities by just doing the right thing, by making the right policy decision. Now, this is a theoretical example because it says that you have to internalize all external costs. But it tells you, by internalizing external cost, it proves the theory that that's the right thing to do. And you must be able to prove it, as Darren also says. Just an infrastructure example, I quickly go through. This is lessons from our work in India. Why do we work in India? If you look at the yellow there, the yellow dots tells you the same amount of people live on the yellow space than on the black space. The same amount. It's the world 50-50, they call it. 46% of the world's population live there. And most of our works in India have a lot of work on the Delhi Kolkata corridor, if you know you. And then if you look at that, half of the people, the same amount of people live in a red spot and in a blue spot. Same amount of people. So this was fun. So we built a freight demand model for India. And we started doing a lot of work. I've been to Varanasi a few times, to Kolkata about 8 times, and to Delhi a little bit more. And Varanasi, the holy city of India, it's in the state of Uttar Pradesh, one of the 36 states of India. And Uttar Pradesh, if it was a country, would have been the 5th most populous country in the world. And then we said, there in Varanasi, we want to build a terminal. And then in Balaga, we want to build a terminal. There's all the planners. Some of my people from Germany and Holland and Zane, those of you that know him, we're all working on this project. And we just 2 business cases. It's one slide, summarized in one slide, Balaga. So they've invested $4 billion in this corridor. I heard this earlier. And we said to them, this was a great plan. We can show that you are going to save the economy of India $1 billion per annum in logistics costs. It will come down by $1 billion. End of story. That's just fantastic. But you know what? You have a problem. This corridor stops on the wrong side of Kolkata. There's congestion in Kolkata, etc., etc., etc. Those of you that know the Alameda corridor in Long Beach in America and those things, if you can build a high volume link to link the end of your corridor to the port or build an extended gate, what can happen? We pressed a few buttons on our model. We said an investment of $500 million will give you another $2 billion per annum. We're able to do this because we have a flow model. If you take Varanasi, it's in a confluence of the Ganga. The Ganga goes further up, but there's a waterway that stops at Varanasi. And it's halfway on a corridor between Kolkata and Delhi. And they were building this 500,000-ton facility. And we went to them and says, you know what? If you look at where you've spaced this terminal of yours, and I look at all the opportunities that you have to save logistics costs, this should have been a 39-million-ton facility. And they believe us. You're going to read the Times of India and some of the newspaper articles there. They're going to build a freight village in Varanasi, based on our recommendation that we've done there. I end with one question in terms of my examples that I haven't answered, but you can take this even on a global level. If you look at this is the world population since 1990, and those are the people who go hungry every day. Okay? This is the food production. So we produced a huge amount of food to bring hunger down a little bit. We know this, but it's gone down a little bit, which is great. This is the amount of food that we throw away. This is essentially a global macro logistics question. Who of you throw away food which will not give it to a hungry person? The food is just not on the right place at the right time. That's it. It's a simple thing. And there is macro logistics solutions for that, that we can look for on a global scale. So what is the future of logistics? I just want to say one thing with South Africa. This, if you look at a World Competitive Forum, they have this measurement of infrastructure. They've got about 100 measurements, lots. Blue is hard infrastructure. You score out of 5. We're not too bad. Orange is maths and science. Well, we are very bad, but we are improving a bit. If you look at rank, obviously rank, the higher you are, the better, the worse. You know, if you sit right at the top, it means you're about 140th out of 140 countries in the world, which is where we were in 2013. If you ask the question, your maths and science education, we were the worst country in the world, the worst. You could pick no other country that was worse. The moment there's 5 countries that are worse than us. Forgot their names. I'm too ashamed to say, but you know, but we improved a little bit. But soft infrastructure is actually our big problem. It's our big problem. You know, I want to end up by saying there's a lot of hype. which is great, about the physical internet, 3D driverless trucks, all of those things, things that we can do, but those are all micro-logistic technology. We need change on a macro level to make these trade-offs, to understand when and what we should do. Why? Because the world is changing. Somebody's talked about the sustainable stuff. People, planet, profit. Okay, so we say it should be in balance. Environmental, social, economic, you know, you can know the story. The bullseye model is emerging. These are the people that protest every year when you have the global COP conferences and so on. They say, well, actually, the most important is the biosphere. Without the world, we are nothing. And then we have to make sure that people are equally treated. And then maybe we can look after the economy. We have the Trump model at the moment, the Mickey Mouse model. You know, economy is everything. And that's where we are. But this will change, and logistics will have to play a role in it. What is the... Pardon?
2 minutes.
That's fine. Good. This I show this slide always, because some people catch on to it and some. This is the global GDP, okay, since 1820. This is trade as a percentage of GDP. If you look carefully, you'll see the gaps narrowing again. Why? Because trade as a percentage of GDP cannot be 100%. It means you export everything that you produce and import everything that you consume. It cannot be. It's already sitting at a third. And this is one of those things that says relocalization, reshoring, moving closer to where we are, not always within your own country, but in Africa, regionalization. Those things are important, are very, very important. They have a profound effect on logistics. And on a macro logistics level, we need the instruments to measure the effects of what we do. I say this often, people don't understand it, because most people that write the textbook are my age, and I was born there, I went to university there, I got my first job there. So I grew up in a world where trade growth did this, but in the last 10 years I've been predicting that trade growth will not grow so fast. And every 3 months the World Trade Organization put their forecast down. They don't want to give a real forecast, because they will realize it's going to go down. You'll see in the last few years it's been flat. My last slide. The biggest change of all is to understand growth. In fact, us, when we talk about the relationship between logistics and GDP and doing this macro logistics trade-offs, we also have to ask questions about GDP. Measurement GDP is inherently got flawed. It's flawed. Why? It does not, if you just speculate on the stock exchange, you don't add value, but you can become rich. Non-market activities, if you grow fruit in your back garden, it's not measured by the GDP. Yeah, that's a big problem. So, and then we don't understand what the effect is of it, certain things is that's happening in the world. If the GDP grows, it doesn't mean that we're all getting richer. It measures quantity and not quality of life. It does not tell you whether people are happy. GDP can be very high and we're not happy. That type of thing on a macro logistics level we have to solve. And then finally, GDP actually ignores the wellness of the environment completely. It encourages natural resource depletion. Because if you use up everything you've got, for the few years that you do it, you actually look good. So, and we need to, these are going to be so profound in terms of what we do in the future, that we need the instrumentation to deal with this. And that's my message.